There is power in do that. Good morning and welcome to St. Mary's. It is lovely to see you on this beautiful sunny day. Excellent. Oh, there's Sue. Hello, Sue. Just saying hello because you're the last on my tick list of people I need to make sure are here. That's brilliant. Hello there. Welcome. Welcome. Come in, birthday girl. Good morning. We will be singing Happy Birthday, as we always do, and we have one particular person who's definitely got a birthday today. So, we were playing the music we played before the service, a song called Break Every Chain, about the power of Jesus to destroy the things that bind us in our lives. But if Jesus has the power to break every chain, the question is, what do we do with that power if it's made available to us? And I found a little poem which I thought was something we might consider doing. It says this: let us build a house where love can dwell and all can safely live, a place where saints and children tell how hearts learn to forgive, built of hopes and dreams and visions, rock of faith and vault of grace, here the love of Christ shall end divisions, and all are welcome, all are welcome, all are welcome here. I think that would be a pretty good thing for us to achieve if we can manage it. And we'll start today. We will sing, we will worship, we will pray, and we will call on Jesus, the power of Jesus, in those broken chains. So welcome to you all. If you don't know me, my name's Mike. I'm the lay minister here. And I'll be leading, and Sue, who is doubling as tech desk, and will also be preaching, and is preaching on something from John's Gospel, which is one of the most bizarre and intricate and complex bits. So she gets the difficult bit. I get to preach on the feeding of the 5,000 next year, which is much easier. So we'll lead up to that for Sue later. We've got no instrumentalists, so we'll be doing our singing against tracks from YouTube, but we have got some singers, hooray, and they will be leading us. Now, we've given you a big build-up there, haven't we?
Oh, yeah.
Right, so let's get you up there then. We've got two songs to sing. It is still Easter. Just because Easter was a week ago doesn't mean Easter has ended. The church sees Easter going on for weeks, if not for eternity. So we have two Easter songs. We're going to tell the Easter story in two songs. The first song, When I Survey the Wondrous Cross, is a Good Friday song. And then we'll step forward instantly to See What a Morning Gloriously Bright, which of course is an Easter Sunday song. So if you can, would you like to stand and we'll sing.
Oh, my pride.
to his blood. See from his head, his hands, his feet, sorrow and love flow, may go down. Did such love and sorrow meet, or thorns compose some richer crown? Where the whole realm of nature mine, that where an offering far too small, love so amazing, so divine, demands my soul.
Shall reign with him.
So the prayer for today, risen Christ, for whom no door is locked, no entrance barred, open the doors of our hearts that we may seek the good of others and walk the joyful road of sacrifice and peace to the praise of God the Father. Amen. Amen. Do grab a seat. Thank you, singers. We will be calling on you again shortly. It was lovely to hear you all singing. Brilliant. We've got some notices. And just to upset the tech team, I'm going to start with number two, which is that one. We've got a couple of courses coming up. These courses are being run by the Deanery, which is the group of churches in Anglican churches in Surrey Heath working together. This is something a bit new, and it's sensible to get the right number of people together, really. And so we've got an Alpha course coming. Who's done an Alpha course? Yeah, lots of you. You can do it again. There's nothing to stop you doing it again. But it's a fantastic introduction to the Christian faith. It's one of those courses where you can ask any question, no question too stupid, and you can do it again. And this is going to be run at St. Barbara's in Deepcut. Now, St. Barbara's is a little tin church which is currently closed, and they're meeting in the brand new primary school behind the place. So it's an interesting excuse if you want to like looking in at new buildings and the school. So it's there. It's starting on the 12th of May, and if you want to do that, you have to contact St. Paul's. There's a website address. All this is in the notice sheets emails that come through to you. And then the other course, which is that one, well done, is Living in Love and Faith. This is a thing being run by the Church of England over the course of a year, and it's looking at the nature of humanity, who we are, and relationships. And obviously, it looks at matters of sexuality and things like that. But it tries to start from the very beginning of where we are, where we stand, how we were made, and the differences between us. I think it's going to be great fun. There's a bunch of us going on this. This one's going to be in Windlesham, yes, St. John the Baptist, and it starts the week after next, and bookings end fairly soon. So if you'd like to do that, do hurry, because it would be great to have a whole bunch of us go from St. Mary's to join in that discussion. So that's that one, and then there's one more, which is a date for your diary. You've probably heard that the Queen has some anniversary or something coming up. And so the whole country is going to be celebrating. And on the 5th of June, on Jubilee weekend, which is also Pentecost Sunday, which is a lovely mixture of things, I think, we're going to be having a picnic in the park. And as you can see from the picture, the sun will shine, the grass will be lush, it's going to be great. So put that in your diary and come and join us and eat your sandwiches together out in the park. I don't know whether the rugby's going to be rushing around, whether we're really hit by balls or as we eat. I don't know. No, they're not. Okay, that's brilliant. Okay, so that's what we're doing. So that's the notices. Then there's the issue of birthdays. We always celebrate birthdays at St. Mary's. Who's got a birthday today? Matilda. Okay. Anyone else? Anyone? Who's had a birthday the past week? Ray? Okay, brilliant. And who's got a birthday coming up? No one in the next week? Oh yes, when's your birthday? 28th, that's really soon now, isn't it? 4 days away. Excellent, any others? Right, well, somebody had a birthday last week, and she was 90 or something or other. 96 was it? Thank you, I'm glad I remember. And she got happy birthday played for her by the Coldstream Guards. So I thought, anything that's good enough for the Queen is good enough for you guys. So here they are.
Over.
So the question is, how do they keep those Busby things on their heads and not have them fall off? Are they glued on or something? I don't know. It looks very clever. Anyway, happy birthday to everyone. But Matilda, come up here a second. Now, it's your birthday today, isn't it?
Yes.
So happy birthday.
Thank you very much.
But it's not just your birthday. There's other reasons why you've got this whole crowd come with you, isn't there?
Lots of praising. And good morning, everybody. Good morning.
Okay, and tell us what you've been doing over the past few months.
Okay. In the last few months, my second daughter, Ori, she got married, registry in the fleet, and then we're not thought of, now that the COVID is gone, that we should be smiling and be happy. And she said, Mom, can I speak to Andrew if I can have my wedding here? I said, oh, that would be great. Because back home, the church is massive church, a lot of people will be there, and we're still running away from the crowd. So when she made mention of that, I said, beautiful, let's go and talk to Andrew. When we spoke to Andrew, Andrew was, wow, that's very good that at least we'll have something nice talking about in the last few months, what has been happening in the country, all over the world. So we started the planning, and I was overwhelmed the way the church supported us. It was a great thing that I've experienced in this church, that my daughter getting married and everybody was looking forward to that date. And on that date, people were still in the hall with us, as if no other thing they have in their mind to do. I was surprised. You were coming on the floor dancing. I was overwhelmed. And then when we said, okay, the back home, the tradition is your daughter, it's not only you that have such a daughter, it's the whole family that have daughter, the whole family that have the son that you have. So everybody must witness the exchange of the agreement that we are getting married or she's going to get married. So back home, everybody also supported us, and I was so happy that all this thing, we went back home, we came back safely, no problem, and the way I just saw everything around me, I just say, God, I cannot ask for more, but what you have done is so great in my life. And today, my birthday, I told somebody the way I was born. I wasn't born in the hospital. My mother didn't knew she was in labor. No pain, nothing. She was going to market. And when they were going in those days, they go in groups, friends, like school children where you see them, maybe four or five going together. So my mom said, she was just telling them, oh, excuse me, it's like I want to wheel or do something. And they said, she put her bowl down, her bag down, and behold, she said, everybody come, it's like no, not pool, it's something else. So all me and the placenta came once. And one of them, they put me in a bowl and took me back like from here to a gas station there. That was the distance from the house to where they burned me. And they now separated the cord. I now appreciated it when my first daughter gave birth, that the cord will not be separated on time. I said, oh, that was a good thing that God made it to happen to me. Because that time, the placenta was still having pulse before they gave me there. And by the time they wanted to cut off, might be the end of the whole thing. So I'm so happy that today I'm celebrating my birthday, And since I was born, no ill health, no problem, and always giving thanks to God on this day. And he still allowed me to have so many testimonies this year. So to everybody around, I say congratulations to us in St. Mary's. I really appreciate you. Thank you very much.
Okay. So going to hospital and coming back with a baby, sorry, going to market and coming back with a baby, that's quite something. That's almost scary, really, isn't it? Can we pray for you and your family? Yeah, come on. Let's have the couple up. Oh, go on. We'll have the lot.
Yes, so I have the lot.
It's lovely to see you all. Yeah. It's good. Wow. Ooh, sorry. Right. Wow. That's half the church. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for Matilda. We pray, we bless her on her birthday. And we pray for the whole family. We particularly pray for our newlywed couple. That's fantastic. And for the whole extended family. Thank you that they've been able to celebrate. They've been celebrating here. They've been celebrating Nigeria. And they bring this culture, joining of cultures. And it's we learn so much. And we thank you, Lord, that you are God of the whole earth. That you are God of Nigeria, as you are God of Britain, as you are God of the entire universe. And we thank you and we pray for your blessing on this family and on ourselves this day and in the years and to come. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. 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 Thank you so much. Right, we're going to hear our Bible reading from Sue, and then Sue's going to speak. If you're the sort of person who likes things to touch and hold and you haven't already, there are some sheets down here with pictures, with word searches, with crosswords. There's an interesting picture to colour of Jesus, where Jesus is wearing a mask. Not quite sure why. I think maybe it's meant to be a beard, but it does look rather like a mask. But do grab those if you want. And Sue... it's all yours.
Thank you. The reading this morning is taken from John chapter 5, verses 31 to 47. And this can be found in the Pew Bibles in the New Testament on page 125 if you wanted to follow it. If I testify on my own behalf, what I say is not to be accepted as real proof. But there is someone else who testifies on my behalf, and I know that what he says about me is true. John is the one to whom you send your messengers, and he spoke on behalf of the truth. It is not that I must have a man's witness. I say this only in order that you may be saved. John was like a lamp burning and shining. And you are willing for a while to enjoy his light. But I have a witness on my behalf, which is even greater than the witness that John gave. What I do, that is, the deeds my Father gave to me, these speak on my behalf and show that the Father has sent me. And the Father who sent me also testifies on my behalf. You have never heard his voice or seen his face. And you do not keep his message in your hearts, for you do not believe in the one who sent me. You study the scriptures because you think that in them you will find eternal life. And those very scriptures speak about me. Yet you are not willing to come to me in order to have life. I'm not looking for human praise, but I know what kind of people you are, and I know that you have no love for God in your hearts. I have come with my Father's authority, but you have not received me. When, however, someone comes with his own authority, you will receive him. You like to receive praise from one another, but you do not try to win praise from the one who alone is God. How then can you believe me? Do not think, however, that I am the one who will accuse you to my father. Moses, in whom you have put your hope, is the very one who will accuse you. If you had really believed Moses, you would have believed me, because he wrote about me. And since you do not believe what he wrote, how can you believe what I say? This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Holy Spirit, take my words and speak to each of us according to our need. Amen. Well, as Mike said, this is quite an interesting passage. And if you were following the church lectionary, you might be interested to discover that this passage is one that isn't very often preached on. I think I worked out why when I sat down to try and work out what God wanted me to say about it. However, what I discovered was fascinating, and it was really interesting to research. So we should have a slide. So I felt this passage feels very much like a courtroom drama, something like we might see on TV. I don't know if you watch Judge Judy or Judge Rinder. It's almost as if Jesus is standing in the dock defending his actions after being cross-questioned by the authorities. In the first part of this chapter, Jesus did what some people felt to be the unthinkable. He performed a miracle on a Sunday, the Sabbath. He healed a lame man. For a while it was unknown who'd done it, but when it's discovered that it was Jesus and he was challenged, it led to the courtroom drama which is unfolding in today's Bible passage. If we'd read the section before this passage, we would have heard, "So, because Jesus was doing these things on the Sabbath, the Jewish leaders began to persecute him. In his defense, Jesus said to them, 'My Father is always at his work to this very day, and I too am working.' For this reason, they tried all the more to kill him. Not only was he breaking the Sabbath, but he was even calling God his own Father, making himself equal with God." I was interested to read that the Ephesians loved a good courtroom drama. And to them, an afternoon of entertainment would entail cramming themselves into the public galleries and listening to the twists and turns of Roman law as whoever was under arrest was being cross-examined. In this story, it would be roughly another 18 months before the Jewish leaders managed to get Jesus into an actual courtroom. But already, they're trying him in the courtroom of their hearts. So, just like in any courtroom, witnesses are brought to the trial. The Jewish authorities feel that they almost have an open and shut case against Jesus. After all, he's gone against biblical teachings by breaking the Sabbath and then blaspheming by calling himself the Son of God. They know their Bible really well. They've been taught in Exodus, "You have 6 days in which to do your work, but the seventh day is a solemn day of rest dedicated to me. Whoever does any work on that day is to be put to death." And then a bit later in Leviticus it says, "Then tell the people of Israel that anyone who curses God must suffer the consequences and be put to death. Any Israelite or any foreigner living in Israel who curses the Lord or blasphemes shall be stoned to death by the whole community." The authorities have no doubt that Jesus is guilty on both counts and needs to go to trial. But then in this passage, we hear Jesus' counterclaims. He brings to the court some witnesses who will be able to support him and testify for him. But first, we hear him say, "If I testify on my own behalf, what I say is not to be accepted as real proof." He isn't saying that his claims aren't true. To understand what he does actually mean, we have to go back to the Old Testament readings again. In Deuteronomy 19:15, it says, "One witness is not enough to convict someone of a crime. At least two witnesses are necessary to prove that someone is guilty. In other words, in Jewish, Roman, and Greek law, the testimony of a single witness isn't valid to find someone guilty or to prove their innocence. Jesus knows that he needs to find more witnesses to prove his innocence, and that's exactly what he's doing in our Bible passage. In fact, Jesus manages to bring at least four witnesses who will be able to vouch for him. His first witness, John the Baptist. We heard at the beginning of our study of John's Gospel, in John 1, it said, "And John gave this testimony. I saw the Spirit come down like a dove from heaven and stay on him. I still did not know that he was the one, but God, who sent me to baptize with water, had said to me, 'You will see the Spirit come down and stay on a man. He is the one who baptizes with the Holy Spirit.' 'I have seen it,' said John, 'and I tell you that he is the Son of God.'" So John was able to testify that Jesus was the Son of God because he had been told by God to look out for him. He needed no convincing. Our second witness is his miracles. And I think my mouse has given up. There we go. These are the miracles he performed up until this time. We read in verse 36, "But I have a witness on my behalf, which is even greater than the witness that John gave. What I do, that is the deeds my Father gave me to do. These speak on my behalf and show that the Father has sent me." Jesus' accusers would have been bystanders at these miracles. They would have seen them happening, yet still they didn't believe who he was. So this comes to our third witness. I'll leave it to you, Ian. Oh, there we go. God himself. At the time of his baptism by John the Baptist, God audibly testified. It says, "Then a voice said from heaven, 'This is my own dear Son, with whom I am pleased.'" Of course, we don't know whether everyone could hear what was said, but if they could, then how could they question it? And our fourth witness, which is probably the most convincing witness of all, is the scriptures. The Jewish authorities claimed to be using the scriptures to convict Jesus of the crimes of working on the Sabbath and blaspheming. But Jesus turns this around, and they become the ones who are actually on trial at this point. Jesus challenges them that if they're so clued up on what the scriptures say, if they're such authorities on what laws to obey to gain eternal life, then how could they have missed what it said about him? We hear, "You study the scriptures because you think that in them you will find eternal life. And these very scriptures speak about me." At this point, it seems as if Jesus almost has them hung, drawn, and quartered. But he lands one last and most brutal statement. "Do not think, however, that I am the one who will accuse you to my Father. Moses, in whom you have put your hope, is the very one who will accuse you. If you had really believed Moses, you would have believed me, because he wrote about me. But since you do not believe what he wrote, how can you believe what I say?" It was Moses who received the laws that they based their whole lives on, that they believed by following would gain their salvation. But they seem to have missed one crucial bit of information. In Deuteronomy 18:15, Moses tells the people, "Instead, he will send you a prophet like me from among your own people, and you are to obey him." And then further on in Deuteronomy, God says, "I will send them a prophet like you from among their own people. I will tell him what to say, and he will tell the people everything I command. He will speak in my name, and I will punish anyone who refuses to obey him. The Jews loved to hear about Moses and his teaching. They lived by being obedient to the command to love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul, with all your strength and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. By obeying these commands, they hoped to gain eternal life. They used Moses' commandments as a basis for their own accusations against Jesus. But in fact, this is where they discover that the tables have turned. They themselves are now on trial rather than Jesus. In Deuteronomy, Moses says, God's curse on anyone who does not obey all of God's laws and teachings. It's at this point that Jesus lets them know that they have failed dismally in this command, and it was apparent that they really didn't believe what Moses said either. If they had, they would know who he was and would rejoice at the coming Messiah. Instead, they're plotting to murder him. The Jewish authorities discover that Moses, the person who they thought would be their number one defendant, is now in fact their strongest accuser. At this time, they have to admit defeat, back down, and go away licking their wounds, to reconvene and make plans to try again later with their plan to get rid of Jesus. It feels as if we've gone on a roller coaster ride of the Old Testament. And I wonder what relevance all this has for us today. Well as the teachings of Moses, the Jewish authorities also had Jesus in front of them. They'd seen the miracles. They had the testimony of John the Baptist. They'd heard God's word when Jesus was baptized. Yet still they failed to see what was right in front of them. I wonder if we do this today. I don't only wonder, in fact I grieve, that we do at times. Yes, we don't actually have Jesus with us. We only have the story of his miracles. We didn't witness them, although we know that miracles can and do still happen. But the one thing that we do have, that the Jewish authorities didn't have, is the second part of the whole story. We have the New Testament with its account of Jesus' death, his resurrection, and the wonders of the Easter story. Last Sunday, we celebrated this at the end of a week where we traveled with Jesus on his last days. We came together to celebrate the assurance of our salvation through the death of the one who loved us so much, he was willing to endure such a horrendous death for us. But just like the Jewish authorities, I wonder, do we still at times put Jesus on trial? Do we try to bargain with him, question him? Do we at times doubt him and his promises, especially when times are hard or we're wobbling in our faith? For myself, I'd love to say no, but then I know that wouldn't be absolutely true. I'm not going to answer the question for everyone else, but I do put the question to you. Do you put him on trial? But we can be comforted in the knowledge that we have a loving and forgiving God. We have a steadfast God who's always there and who we can base our lives and everything that we do on. We have a God who is there with us through thick and thin, through good times and hard times. We have a God who gave his only begotten Son that we would gain everlasting life. And that for me is a God who I want in my life. And that is a Jesus who I want to stay close to. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you so much that we do have the Easter story. But we admit that at times we may doubt you, we may question you, we may ask. And I pray that at those times we're able to grasp onto the knowledge that Jesus died for us so that we do have the assurance of salvation. Allow us to keep that at the forefront when we're going through troubling times. Amen.
So, do we put Jesus on trial, I think was the question Sue left us with. And I think, and she left us with the fact that we have the Easter story, which is the evidence that the people in that Jesus was talking to, the Jews, didn't have, because we had the evidence of what happened on the cross and afterwards. And we have that as evidence of God's love. Jesus said in the passage, I know what kind of people you are. You have no love for God in your hearts. But we have the evidence of how much God loves us. So we're going to sing about that love. We're going to sing two songs. We're going to sing How Deep the Father's Love for Us, Vast Beyond All Measure. And then if you can get to the end of that song, we're going to sing a great song of praise. Praise the name of the Lord our God. So let's stand and sing.
In anything, no gifts, no power. cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb. The entrance sealed by heavy stone, Messiah still and all
Take a seat. We come to a time of prayer, a time of confession and intercession. Sue described how Jesus used the example of a legal trial where people are accused and their behaviour is tested against the rules set down in law. And we know that Jesus faced two trials himself. And trials are scary. And we know that both of Jesus' trials were rigged. And in the Lord's Prayer, which we'll say in a little while, we ask God not to lead us into temptation, but there's an alternative translation of that, which is that we ask God that he will not bring us to the time of trial, because trials are scary. And in today's reading, Jesus accused his enemies of blindness, of failing to see the obvious, the evidence of who he is. But the good news is that if we confess the mistakes we've made, we confess our blindness, he's faithful and will forgive us. So we've got a chance now to look at our own blindness and to say sorry for our sins. And we're going to slowly work through a series of confession statements. We'll just have a little break between each one to give us a chance to think about what they might mean. So please say these with me. We confess we have failed to honour God, to recognise who he is. We have failed to see the example of Jesus and to follow him. We have failed to allow the Holy Spirit to reign in our lives. We have failed to care for each other. We have failed to care for the world. And we have failed to care for ourselves, recognizing the image of God in which we are made. But God is merciful, and mercy triumphs over judgment. So let's pray. May our merciful Father forgive us our sins and restore us in his image to the praise and glory of his name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now Kay is going to come and lead us in our intercessions.
Heavenly Father, we come before you today to pray for ourselves and the world we live in. We thank you for the universe you created, for the wonder of the myriad stars, planets and galaxies which go on forever, and for one particular little planet that we call home. In its uniqueness, it's home to such a diverse amount of life forms, plants and trees, animals, birds, fish, insects, all with their own special place in the ecosystem. Yet only one creature has the ability to adversely affect life on Earth, and that's us. Mankind. Help us to realise that we need to protect our home, and that by abusing it we put the future of every living thing at risk. Thank you for those who campaign on ecological issues and highlight what is happening in our world. And we think especially of the broadcaster Sir David Attenborough, recently recognised as a champion of Earth by the United Nations, whose amazing and awe-inspiring documentaries have shown the damage our way of life is doing to the planet. Every nation on Earth should be working to live harmoniously together, and yet we know that doesn't happen. Around the world, there are many areas of conflict, some in the headlines, others which are not. And we lift these to you now, Lord, and ask you to bring a peaceful ending to the devastation they cause. And we think especially of the Ukraine and the aggressive behaviour of Russia. Praying for everyone grieving loved ones killed in this atrocious situation, or those being forced to leave their homes for safety in other parts of the country or even countries outside Ukraine. We pray that you will soften the heart of President Putin to change his plans for his special campaign in Ukraine. And we pray for all world leaders as they respond to the situation there too. We pray, Lord, for our own country and for our Queen, Elizabeth, on the occasion of her 96th birthday. and give thanks for her strong faith and her many years of service to you and to us, her people. We ask for your continued protection over her and look forward to the Jubilee celebrations at the beginning of June. We pray for our government at this difficult time. May those in positions of leadership understand that the country needs and wants to be led by people of honesty and integrity, that have the best interests of the nation at heart, rather than furthering their own political futures. To understand the pressures that their policies place on everyone, that more and more individuals and families are finding it harder and harder to cope financially through no fault of their own. To act with compassion towards everyone, and especially those who come to our shores seeking a new life, that they will know they will be treated with dignity and respect. And now we pray, Lord, for all who are in need of your loving touch in their lives at this time, those who are grieving, those who have health issues, physical or mental, and for those situations known only to us. We lift them to you now. Gathering all these prayers together, we say the prayer that Jesus taught the disciples. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you, Kay. Well, we're coming to the end of our service, but not quite. Because plans are always being disrupted in interesting ways, aren't they? And I've been, the Matilda's family have asked if we can have a, sing a particular song. So who's got the phone with the song on it? Would you like to go to the tech desk? I'm going to say a final prayer, and then we'll hear this song. And I believe someone is going to... Is it Matilda? Are you going to come through with the family have asked specifically if an offering can be taken for the work of the church. Now, many of us give via electronic means, and so maybe that it's not appropriate. But if you have felt called, if you have money for the church, then Matilda will come through with the plate. But let me pray while they're plugging things in. May the love of the Lord Jesus draw us all to himself. May the power of the Lord Jesus strengthen us in his service this week. May the joy of the Lord Jesus fill our hearts and our souls. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among us and remain with us forever. Amen. How are we going? Oh, yes, yes. Matilda reminds me that there are things to eat at the back, so don't go away without those. As well as tea and coffee, of course.
Yes.
Are we going? Are we going? Let's go.